God, our Father, and our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. As we continue this worship series focusing on the Small Catechism today, we're focusing on the Lord's Prayer, one of the best known elements of our faith. Who taught the Lord's Prayer to you? What are some of your first memories of it? It would be so fun to hear all of your different memories of the Lord's Prayer, and maybe we can share some of that a little bit later on. One of my first memories was wondering why trespassing was such a problem in Jesus' time. The only places I ever saw anything about trespassing were on people's property with the no trespassing signs, you know? My sister trespassed and came into my room all the time, but I had no problem forgiving her for that because I trespassed into her room sometimes, too. I also remember going to my grandma's Catholic church and finding myself doing the Lord's Prayer solo at the end, since her church ended the prayer before mine did. I think probably the questions I most frequently hear on the Lord's Prayer are about different versions. Why are there different versions? You've got the old version with the old English, the one without, you've got trespasses, you've got sins, you've got debts. And why do we have to ask God to not lead us into temptation? Would God really do that? The different versions are reflections of the different translations of the Bible. The Lord's Prayer is found in Matthew 6, which we heard. It's also found in Luke 11. Both versions are a little bit different. In the New Revised Standard Version of the Bible, which is what most mainline churches use in worship as we do, Matthew used debts and debtors, and Luke uses sins. And if you use a whole other version of the Bible, you might find trespasses there. So over the years, different denominations adopted different versions of the Lord's Prayer, so that when you visited another church, you'd likely be stumbling through a version that was different from the one that you knew. Until the 1970s, when a council of Christians from all over the world got together to agree on one single version of the creeds and the Lord's Prayer so that we could all be united praying the same words together. They wanted to choose a version that was in a language that we understand best and was closest to the translations of the Bible that we use. That's how the version beginning with Our Father in Heaven, with sins and those who sin against us, was adopted to be used globally. But as you may know, change doesn't always come easily in the church. People like the versions they grew up with, and they were reluctant to learn a new one. So while some churches used the ecumenical version that was agreed upon starting in the late 1970s, others retained their original versions, the traditional ones. Still others choose and chose to continue to use both of them. And perhaps that's a good compromise. It's good to know and to use both of them. You may know one and like one above the other, but there are others who know and like the other one better than the one that you like. But whatever version of the Lord's Prayer we pray, we're praying as Jesus taught us. I think it's important to look at the Lord's Prayer in parts because it forces us to really slow down and think about what we're praying rather than reciting it from memory as we've done hundreds of times before. Considering Luther's explanations can be helpful as well because they show how this prayer is a personal one for us. Yes, God's name is holy in itself, but we're asking that it become holy in and among us, that we can help keep it holy. God's kingdom coming doesn't really rely on us, nor does God's will rely on our praying for it, but we're praying that God's kingdom will also come in and among us, that God's will be done in and among us. In essence, we not only want God's plan to come about, but we want to be a part of it, both here and in heaven. Instead of waiting for heaven, for life to be exactly as we would have it, we're asking for God to bring heaven to earth. We're asking God to use us to accomplish that. Have you thought about that? That when we make someone's life better here, that we're participating in God's will being done here, participating in God's kingdom coming to someone in this life, not just the next. You've just read the Give Us Today Our Daily Bread petition with the exhaustive list of all of the things that are our daily bread. So you know that a daily bread isn't just about food. Our daily bread is everything we need for life, food and clothing, shelter, relationships, everything. God will continue giving us these things even if we don't pray for them, but we're asking God to continually help us appreciate what we've been given rather than taking it for granted. God is our provider every day of our lives and every day of our eternal lives. The fifth petition that we'll get to shortly is one that's easy to kind of gloss over. We're just asking God to forgive us, right? But if you read it carefully, forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Forgive us in the same way that we forgive others who sin against us. Yikes. We're asking God to be as forgiving as we are. What do you think about that? I suppose it depends how good you are at forgiving. If God forgave you as well as you forgave others, what would that look like? This is one of the sentences that Jesus spoke that we kind of like to reorganize a little bit. Forgive us our sins and teach us to forgive anyone who sins against us. Sounds much better, right? But that's not what he said. For some reason, Jesus took this opportunity to emphasize that while it's important for us to be forgiven, it may be even more important for us to forgive. Forgiveness isn't saying that what the other person did was okay. It's saying that you're not going to let that person's sin hang over you like a dark cloud. You're not going to let that person's sin fester inside you like an unhealed wound. Forgiveness is the beginning of healing. It's a choice to free yourselves from grudges that likely cause you more stress and bitterness than they cause the person who sinned against you. Forgiveness isn't forgiving, nor is it opening ourselves up to be hurt in the same way again. It's letting go. It's freeing ourselves from the burden of carrying that sin around like a bag of bricks. So forgiveness is difficult for you. Work on it. Write down what you need to forgive, who you need to forgive. Then rip it up or burn it. Do it multiple times if you need to. Repeat it out loud to yourself like a mantra. Think about how good you'll feel being free of that grudge. It's worth the effort for your own wholeness and for the one you need to forgive. This petition reminds us that, yes, God will forgive us, but it also reminds us of how much our life and our faith rests on our ability to forgive as we've been forgiven. We don't deserve God's forgiveness, but he does forgive us, and we are to do likewise. The sixth and seventh petitions are our plea for God to walk with us and protect us during difficult times. Sometimes those difficult times are things that happen to us. Sometimes those difficult times are of our own making. It's almost as if we're saying, protect us, God, from evil, protect us from harm, and please, Lord, protect us from ourselves. Certainly bad things happen in this world that we have no control over, but it's almost more difficult to deal with the things that we do have control over. How many times have you wished you had access to a do-over button so that you could undo what you had just said or done? In these petitions, we ask that God lead us away from the bad things that tempt us, that God would help us deal with the trials, that we may make the best choices and persevere when we're tested. God's strength is stronger than our own strength. God's wisdom is wiser than ours. So we ask for a good dollop of strength and a sprinkling of wisdom to deal with the things that life hands us and the messes that we make ourselves. We pray this prayer knowing that God is always working to defeat evil, and that when this life is over, we'll enter a new life where evil will be no more. So we ask God to sustain us in this life until we're blessed in the next. The final section of the Lord's Prayer was added on in some of the later translations of the Gospels, and probably not original, which is why some churches don't include it, or they include it a little bit after the rest of the prayer. It's called the doxology, or the conclusion. For yours is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. And it reminds us that it's not all about us, it's about God. None of the glory, none of the power, none of the kingdoms truly depend on us or belong to us. God is in charge. God is worthy of our glory and praise now on earth and forever in God's kingdom. The Lord's Prayer is special, not because of how we learned it or where we learned it or how many times we say it, but because Jesus taught it to us and asks us to pray it. It reminds us who God is, how God has blessed us, how God continues to guard us, and that God is truly in charge. And as you pray it, remember that you are praying it with millions of people all over the world who join you in this prayer for all of time. Amen.